Divine Truth Interviews. Jesus, Mary, and others are interviewed by members of the media and the public.
Jesus is interviewed by Mary Magdalene on the topic of cults. The interview was held on the 10th of June 2014 in Wilkesdale, Queensland, Australia. This is session 3.
Welcome to our third session in our discussion of cults. Now, there's many reasons why people find it difficult on earth today to trust that a person has good intentions and a pure heart. Hopefully in this discussion, we'll highlight some of those things. A lot of the questions we're going to talk about today come from people who, after many years of listening to Divine Truth, still have doubts about what we teach and especially about the character of Jesus, who's with me here today to go through the questions. So a lot of the questions you're going to hear are actually driven by fears, especially fears about religion and money. But we feel it's good to work through them and let you hear the answers. Yeah. So I hope you enjoy our session.
Yes. And also a lot of these questions have been taken by people scouring the internet, I suppose you could say, looking for evidences of how you can recognise a cult. And I find many of the questions quite amusing in a lot of ways, because if you use these particular things as evidence to see a cult, then you'll probably see cults in pretty much everything in your daily life.
That's right. A lot of the questions are based upon checklists and of different features of cults. Yeah. And a lot of these features you'll find in governments and in religions and even in some families.
In a lot of families.
So it's interesting to explore. Certainly, I don't think we agree that any of these features are loving.
No.
So if governments and families and religions all got rid of these features, the world would definitely be a much better place. But maybe we should get on and just talk about, go through the questions.
Go through these questions, yeah.
One key warning sign for a cult is that they have a leader who tells everyone what to do. Do you tell people what to do?
Yeah, and they never listen. No, it's not like that at all. Yes, I agree, for a start, that any leader who tells other people what to do or bosses them around in their personal life in particular, obviously that's not a good sign that leader has a good intention or a pure heart. Mm-hmm. And we don't do that at all. In fact, the majority of people who come to us complain that we don't do it enough because they want, many times people want somebody to tell them what to do because they're not willing to work through their own life and work through what they want to do with their life, and nor do they want to take responsibility for their life. So a lot of people are very attracted to other people or a book telling them what to do. Mm-hmm. So I find this definition of being a cult leader quite interesting, because it's really saying that anybody who believes in the Bible is a member of the cult, because the book tells you things to do, gives you commandments that you must follow. And therefore, under this definition of a cult, then any person who practices anything that the Bible teaches would be a member of a cult. Mm. And then if you look at other organisations, for example, almost every pleasure-based organisation, like club or has a set of rules where people tell you what to do. So that means they are a cult too now, does it? So I do agree that many of the organisations on the earth have been set up right from the family onward, where they have a lot of rules that they then enforce. Mm-hmm. And oftentimes it's our parents that started to enforce these particular things. And then, of course, it turned into enforcement by an organisation, some kind of, entity that doesn't have any real personality to it, because it's a conglomeration of people and it turns into an organisation. And then the organisation enforces its own rules. And I disagree with all of such things. I feel the only rules that need to be enforced, if you could say enforced, are the rules associated with love. And the way they're enforced is by just God's laws already enforce them.
Yeah.
Like God's universe already enforces these laws of love. And the way God enforces laws is very gently. Mm-hmm. There's an operation that occurs upon your soul and you will be corrected every single time. So the question was, do I tell people what to do? No, I don't. I do give suggestions to people when they ask me.
Mm-hmm.
So if a person says to me, you know, how do you think I should deal with this particular problem in my family? Well, I'll say, well, what does love dictate you do here in this particular situation? And if a person comes to and asks me, what should I do with my work? Well, what would love of yourself dictate you do with your work? And what would love of your environment dictate you do with your work? And what would love of the people who are at work dictate what you do mm-hmm. at work? Mm-hmm. But in the end, every person must make their own choice and decision. And I am not responsible for anyone's decisions. And I have no desire to be responsible for anyone's decisions at all, because I feel most people's decisions are not based around love and unfortunately based around other things. And I certainly wouldn't want to be responsible for any of their decisions as a result. So we don't tell people what to do ever, as you know.
Yeah.
A lot of people would like us to, but of course we avoid doing such a thing. But we do give suggestions about what love would do.
And certainly, I know we both come from this approach, but what I notice you doing is that you encourage people to understand that they have the gift of choice and the gift of will.
Mm.
And when it comes to tackling a situation in their life, while you may discuss what love would do, you're always very certain to emphasise that it's the person's responsibility to make that decision and that they do have choices and that they're allowed to make choices.
And not only that, that when they do make a choice, God's laws have certain effects upon their soul depending on the type of choice they make. So I just tell them the truth about the way God's laws work and the way that, you know, God has created these laws all surrounding the issues of love and the use of your will and truth and so forth. And once I tell them those truths, many people then feel like they are being pushed into a certain direction.
Mm-hmm.
But I feel that's because they are now feeling guilty about their own feelings of making their own choices. A person who truly wants to love would be totally open to any concept regarding love and totally desirous of following those concepts if they really wanted to. So, but we don't enforce any of those things. We just encourage people to be more loving in their day-to-day life. And we certainly don't tell people what to do, because it's honestly, most people wouldn't do what I told them to do anyway.
Mm-hmm.
I do what I tell myself to do. That's the only person in my life that gets told what to do, me by myself. And I don't even tell you what to do, as you know.
No, that's very true.
Mm.
And how do you deal with someone who, after you've had a discussion with them about what love would do, do you withdraw love from those people or withdraw your friendship from those people?
Not at all.
If they make a choice that's not in harmony with
you? Yeah, not at all. My love and friendship is available to all. However, if that person decides to treat me harmfully, well, in other words, they become very angry about my statements about what love would do, and they get all upset because they're not doing it and they don't want to or whatever, and then they become very angry with me about that. Well, then I then say to the person, well, you're now no longer being loving to me,
mm-hmm.
and I don't like that, and I don't want to put up with that from you, so I'm not going to see you and while you're being unloving to me.
Yeah.
And so, yes, there are many times when I've said to people, no, you can't come along to one of my seminars anymore because you're being unloving to me. And that's my right. It's my seminar. I'm mm-hmm. allowed to do what I like with it.
Mm.
And that's not controlling a person. There's still, like, every single thing that we do gets placed on the internet for free. They could go along to every seminar just by watching what's on the internet if they wanted to.
Yep.
So it's not like they're being prevented from receiving more truth if they really wanted it. They're just being prevented from treating me badly.
Yeah.
And I don't agree with anybody treating me badly, just like I don't agree with myself treating anybody else badly.
Yeah. Thanks. One key warning sign for a cult is that they have a leader who wants to control others. Do people do what you want them to do?
Well, I suppose you could first ask, do I want to control others? No, I don't. In fact, I couldn't think of anything worse than trying to control somebody else.
Why is that such a bad thing?
Well, it's a terrible thing, because whenever you try or attempt to control somebody else, you're trying to manipulate their will. And one of the teachings that I'm teaching of divine truth is that nobody should manipulate your will. You should engage your own will positively And if you engage your will positive, you'll get positive results. And if you engage your will negatively or out of harmony with love, you'll get negative results. So I don't want to control somebody's will. I would like them to have control over their own will.
Yeah.
And that means me not telling them what to do, but rather that they learn how to do things for themselves. So to me, it's a very bad thing to attempt to control the will of another person. Mind you, I see lots and lots of religions doing it,
mm-hmm.
And lots of political parties doing it. And in fact, if you have a good look at around it, most business organisations on the earth are all trying to do it,
yeah.
Which means all of them are cults by this definition.
Mm-hmm.
And yet it's something I don't do. I don't have any desire to control other people. I don't have any desire to make them feel controlled even.
Mm-hmm.
But it is important that they do understand that there are laws, God's laws, that govern the results of their actions. Where if their actions are in harmony with love, then God's laws will reward their actions. And if their actions are out of harmony with love, then God's laws penalise their soul for their actions. And we need to understand these particular laws that are in function all the time in the universe. But why would one individual ever wish to control another? At the end of the day, each person needs to do their own thing.
Mm-hmm.
And then you get to see the real person. You mm-hmm. get to see what's coming from their heart. You get to see what their real desires are, what their real passions are. You get to see the real personality. So this is why I don't even want to control you,
mm-hmm.
you know, my person who I'm in a relationship with, because if I tried to control you, then I wouldn't be getting you, the real you. I'd be getting you, the person you think you have to be for my sake.
Yeah.
And that's nothing like having a decent relationship at all, in my opinion. And in fact, every relationship I've ever observed that does that is a terrible relationship and certainly not something that I would like for myself.
Mm-hmm.
So people seem to think that just because I'm claiming to be Jesus, that I have to have a desire to, you know, take control over them. But I'm basically saying, I'm Jesus, so you have to listen to me. I'm not saying that at all. I'm saying I'm Jesus, certainly.
Mm-hmm.
But you don't have to listen to me. Nobody does.
Mm-hmm.
And in fact, the majority of people on earth don't, actually.
Yeah.
And the majority of people on earth never have either listened to me. Evidence is the reality that we have on earth in terms of all the wars and the trouble and the strife and the pain and suffering. If you listen to me, you would have had a different result. So
yeah.
So this is all evidence that you're not listening to me, and also evidence that I have no desire to control what you respond to in terms of what I say.
Yeah.
So I find again, this is another question that's asked to us quite frequently, and yet if I look at the world's religions and what they do and the world's politicians and what they do, this is the kind of thing they do.
Mm-hmm.
And yet I'm being accused of running a cult and I don't do it.
Yeah.
And I find that quite amusing.
Yeah. I'm glad you find it amusing. I don't often find it amusing.
No, well, I just find it amusing that often we are accused of what other people, that in fact many times the very person who's accusing us is doing.
Yeah.
And I find that very amusing when somebody who's actually doing it to me is attempting to control me and belittle me and manipulate me and do all the other things, tells me that I'm doing that, you know, like, no, I'm not doing any of those things.
Yeah, it's pretty sort of ironic, yeah.
Well, it's an indication, isn't it, that just because a person feels, most people on earth feel that they can use the term cult and then brand that with to anything they don't like, and then everyone will believe them. And I think the proof of anything is in the works that the person achieves or does.
Yeah.
And if anybody looks at my life, they will see that I have no desire to control any single person, and I resist very strongly any desire on their part to be controlled.
Yeah.
I don't even engage. When I know when a person does want to be told what to do, I won't even tell them what to do.
Yeah.
Always leave it up to their own desire and their own opinion. And that's because I feel very strongly that they need to learn how to use their own will.
Yeah.
Yeah. So many other people don't. There's other people around the world who claim to be Jesus. Of course, they're doing exactly what these people were accusing them of. And they are running a cult because they are telling people what to do, bossing them around, you know, giving them, doing all of these things that are the signs of a cult.
Mm-hmm.
But just because I'm claiming to be Jesus, it doesn't mean that I'm doing the same thing.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
And I think, correct me if I'm wrong in this assumption or this understanding, a lot of people historically who have controlled the lives of other people, they've lived in close proximity with a lot of those people, mm. and they've used sort of threats and blackmail and emotional and physical techniques mm. To actually physically and emotionally control those people. Mm. Now, just from a logistical perspective, because it's just you and me living alone in the bush, yeah. and we hardly see anyone.
And we don't have a compound and we don't have any people living with us or anything like that.
It's practically impossible to control anyone.
Exactly. Yeah. And the people who have moved out here, as the media have suggested, most of them have moved away now because they thought that they were going to be involved with something that they imagined that they were going to be involved with. And not understanding my desire at all, mm-hmm. and not understanding that I was never going to tell them what to do, and I was never going to, make their life for them.
Yeah.
So the reality is quite different to the accusation.
Yeah.
Yeah.
One key warning sign for a cult is that they have a list of written rules for followers. Mm. Do you have a list of written rules that people must follow if they wish to come to your seminars?
No, I don't. And my feeling is there's only one rule, and that is, do you want to be loving or you don't want to be loving? Mm-hmm. One of the two. And the rule is, if you want to engage in my seminars, you can come along for free as long as you want to be loving. And if you don't want to be loving, then I don't want you there.
Yeah.
And I'd rather that you don't come.
Yeah.
And that's the rule.
Yeah.
And it's one rule. And yes, it is my definition of loving, certainly. But I can reassure people that my definition of loving is a lot better than what I've observed everyone else's definition of loving happens to be at this point.
Yeah.
And so, yes, I'm trying to put into practice God's definition of loving. And so that means that if you desire to harm another person at a seminar or something that we do, and or you desire to harm myself or Mary, you, at some of the events, you wish to attack us or you wish to denigrate us or humiliate us or pull us down, then yes, you're going to be asked to leave, mm-hmm. because that's my rule. My rule is don't do that to anybody. It's not loving to do that to anybody. No matter what you think of them, it's not loving to do that to anybody. Now, again, I observe many, many religious organisations and political organisations and other organisations have a long list of written rules.
Yeah.
And I don't feel they're very necessary. If the underlying rule in every organisation on the planet was love, and the underlying rule in every interaction was love, then at the end of the day, you wouldn't need all these other rules. These other rules are needed because nobody knows how to love, mm-hmm. or nobody wants to love. Mm-hmm. That's why the rules are needed. Now, under the definition of this question, all of those organisations that created all of these rules, which we don't have,
yeah.
Would all be cults. And yet they're not classified as such generally. So I find it interesting that we have no written rules whatsoever and yet we're classified as a cult, when a lot of these other organisations who are accusing us of being a cult have a long list of written rules
mm.
that they forcefully apply mm-hmm. to the point of expulsion
yeah.
of their particular organisation when you don't go along with the written rules. And yet very few of the rules are actually based around what is loving or truthful.
Mm.
It's all based around what they believe is right or wrong and not necessarily what is loving or truthful.
Yeah, mm. yeah. I suppose the other only rule that we have when attending a seminar is that people need to know that they're going to be filmed.
Yes, but that's not really a rule. It's just a case in point. Like we've got three or four cameras around the place. Of course, at one point or another, you're going to get filmed, and that's the way it is.
Yeah.
Like if you don't want to be filmed, then don't come.
Yeah.
And you can still watch the film on a video. You still see it on the internet for free. It's not like you're missing out on anything. But if you're worried about your face appearing on the camera, then my suggestions are that you're worried about living your life somehow. And my suggestion to that is, well, I'll try to work through that fear if that's a fear that you have. And we have cameras around us all the time, and we don't have any problem with that at all. We feel it's a great way of demonstrating the reality of the occurrence of an event. And it's also a great way to demonstrate our openness and our truthfulness with everyone that we meet. And so everyone knows who've come to a seminar knows that exactly what is on the videos that they see on the internet is exactly what happened at the seminar.
Mm-hmm.
And there's nothing removed from it, aside from maybe a few things like, housekeeping things like where to go to the toilet and things like
yeah.
that. And there's nothing that's removed from the seminar at all. And that then should engender some kind of trust in the fact that we are open and honest and transparent in everything that we do.
Yeah.
Now, I find it very interesting that I am completely open and honest and transparent in everything that we do. We don't manufacture anything. And yet quite often when the media comes to ask us questions, they want us to manufacture fake situations in order for them to get their shot.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that is something that we never do.
Mm.
So quite often the very thing we're accused of doing, which we don't do, is the very thing that the media or others who are the accusers of us do themselves.
Yeah.
And I find the hypocrisy of that quite obnoxious at sometimes.
Yeah.
Because I see people, you know, accusing us of things which they themselves are hypocritically at that same moment attempting to do.
Yeah.
And I feel that's pretty dishonest. So, but in terms of our own venues, as you know, no, there's no problems with that at all. There's
yeah.
no written laws, written rules. There's no thing that you've got to do aside from wanting to grow in love.
Yeah.
And you're welcome to come along if you want to grow in love. If you don't want to grow in love, then don't come along. But don't think that there's some compound at our house where everybody's enforced to grow in love, because there's no compound and there's nobody there aside from Mary and I. However, we are both very dedicated to growing in love,
yeah.
Which is our primary motivation for doing everything.
Yeah.
Mm.
One key warning sign for a cult is that they use character assassination to manipulate people. Do you use character assassination in order to force or coerce people into accepting your teachings?
Well, to me, character assassination is an unloving thing. So why would I ever do an unloving thing when I'm trying to promote love, right? So no, I don't use character assassination in order to force or manipulate or coerce people. In fact, I don't try to force or manipulate or coerce anybody ever using any technique,
yeah.
let alone using an unloving technique. I don't even try to use a loving technique. I don't try to give them a carrot or a stick.
Yeah.
In order to help them become more loving, I just talk to them about the principles of love, and hopefully through their own desire, they decide that they're going to become more loving in their day-to-day life. That's what I would love to see occur. Of course, that is not what always occurs, but that's what I would love to see happen. So all I'm trying to do is encourage a person to utilize their own desire and develop their own desire to become more loving themselves. And force is not a way to make a person become more loving. I know that. I'm not stupid.
Yeah.
Now, I do see, again, many religions and many other organisations on this planet using force as a way of coercing or manipulating people. You know, we see this happening in every religious faith, generally, and particularly in the religious faiths that are what you would classify as fundamental.
Yeah.
So you see in fundamental religious faiths, of which you can classify many Muslim faiths or strains of the Muslim religion,
yeah,
and many Christian strains mm-hmm. of religion are very much engaged in coercion and manipulation of others. And my suggestion to people is get out of it. You know, don't any longer put up with that, because that is out of harmony with the use of your will, and it's also out of harmony with love.
Yeah.
It's out of harmony with, you know, desire. And do you think that God is going to approve of you when you do something that you were forced to do in the first place? I doubt it.
Hmm.
God's going to approve of you when you decide to do something that's loving through the exercise of your own will, not through somebody trying to force or manipulate or coerce you to do it.
So really you're talking about a difference in motivation. When someone's character assassinated or coerced or forced, the motivation for change would be guilt or fear.
Yeah.
Whereas you are talking about engendering in people or
encouraging in people
a motivation of love. Is that
To develop a desire to be motivated by love even.
Yeah.
What I find today is that most people don't even have a desire to be motivated by love. And what I'm attempting to do is encourage people through telling them the truth to have a desire to be motivated by love. What I'm telling them is that there is rewards for living a loving life,
mm-hmm.
and there are also there's pain and suffering that comes from living an unloving life, and we need to learn how to live a loving life if we're ever going to see pain and suffering disappear from the earth. And so what I'm trying to do is encourage people to develop a desire to live a loving life.
Yeah.
Now, you don't do that by manipulating them, and you don't do it by coercing them. You don't do it by the carrot or the stick.
Yeah.
And to me, character assassination is just a stick
yeah.
that other people use. You know, I notice a lot of people use it. I don't do that. However, if a person comes to me and says, like, why do you feel, you know, I feel this way towards that person? I'll say to them, well, that's because you've got this very dark emotion inside of you that says, I want to harm that person.
Yeah.
And I don't call that character assassination. I call that just a presentation of the truth of what's in the person to the person.
So could you contrast that? Contrast the presentation of truth mm-hmm. about what's truly in a person's soul condition with what character assassination is.
Well, character assassination does not care what's in the soul of the person.
Mm-hmm.
What it does is it attempts to assassinate the character of the individual without actually knowing what's inside the person. Every person who ever speaks to me does at some point recognize that they do have the motivation that I'm talking to them about. I don't judge their motivation. And I also continue to love them even though they have that motivation.
Yeah.
I don't treat them badly because of the motivation. I don't try to pull them down or tell them how bad they are because of the motivation.
Mm-hmm.
But I do attempt to tell them the truth
mm-hmm.
about their motivation. So there are people, and there are literally millions, billions, in fact, of people who are motivated by poor motivations. I agree. And if somebody comes to me and asks the question, do you feel I'm motivated by poor motivation? And if I do feel they are, then I'll say, yes, I feel you are. Here is the poor motivation that I have observed.
Yeah.
But it will only be something that I've observed or can feel within them. And I certainly wouldn't attempt to then pull them down as a result of that poor motivation. I'm just telling them what they've asked me. So, and as everybody knows, who knows me knows, I only tell people who ask me or people who force themselves upon me anything about their nature or character, depending upon what happens in our interactions.
Mm-hmm.
So if a person comes up and says, look, do you feel I have a, you know, motivation in this? I'll be honest with what my feelings are. They've asked me for my feelings, and it would be dishonest of me, in fact, to share them.
To share them
in a lying fashion, to lie to them, it'd be dishonest of me. Or to withdraw from sharing with them at all would also be not giving them what they asked for.
Yeah.
And I don't do those particular things. I try to give people what they ask for if it's in harmony with the laws of love and I'm not feeding their addictions. And I also attempt to let people know the truth whenever I feel I do know it.
Mm-hmm.
And it doesn't mean that I always do even know it. But people will find that most of the time, if they ask me about their personal condition, I will tell them the truth, and later on in their life they will find out that I was probably right about their personal condition, not because I'm right about everything, but rather because I can feel their condition.
Yep.
Now, that's different to me than character assassination. Character assassination is a purposeful attempt to destroy a person's character, and I've had that happen to me very frequently, where people, particularly in the media or in religious faiths and so forth, have attempted to destroy my character without knowing me at all,
mm-hmm.
without caring about me at all, without caring about my underlying motivations at all, without caring about whether they were even truthful or not.
Yeah.
And that is character assassination. So what I find happens to me frequently at the hands of other people is character assassination. But what I do with those people is certainly not that.
Yeah.
What I do with people is answer honestly their questions
mm-hmm.
if they ask them
yeah.
or if they have a personal interaction with me, which I am forced to engage through their force,
yeah.
I will also answer them.
Yeah. Okay, great. One key warning sign for a cult is that they attack people to force an emotional response.
Mm.
Do you attack people in order to make them have an emotional response?
Definitely not. And in fact, I feel that any person who attacks another person in order to force an emotional response is way out of line with regard to love. The media does this with me all the time.
Mm-hmm.
They're constantly trying to attack me so that I'm forced into having an emotional response they're trying to make me angry
yeah.
is what their underlying motivation is, or trying to make me feel ashamed, or trying to make me admit things that I can't admit to and so forth. But I don't do that with other people, no, as you know.
Mm.
I don't even do that in our relationship,
mm-hmm.
let alone in our public life. So, you know, I'm never trying to force a person by or force an emotional response out of a person by attacking them. There are times when people become emotional with me, but mostly it's because I'm stating to them things they already know inside of their heart to be true. And as soon as they connect to that truth, they have an emotional experience. So that's what happens very frequently. And many people can observe that in the 1,200 hours of videos of seminars that we have. You'll see that happening very frequently.
Yeah.
Where I say to the person, no, I feel it's this. And as soon as I start talking about the truth about this subject, the person starts crying and they know in their heart that it is the thing that I'm saying. And to me, that I'm not trying to attack them to get an emotional response. What I'm trying to do is help them have a connection with their suppressed emotions, which certainly I do. I try to help all people connect with their suppressed emotions and allow those emotions to flow, which I feel is very, very different than attacking a person in order to get an emotional response.
Yeah. One key warning sign for a cult is that they control the relationships of followers. Do you control what relationships people have?
Well, firstly, I think a lot of these questions use the term followers all the time, and I've got to address this.
Yeah.
We don't have followers. We have people who come along to seminars and who come along to events that we hold for free, and most of them don't follow us at all. In fact, most of them we don't even know. They're definitely not what I would classify as a follower. If we're talking about a follower in terms of a person who's attempting to practice the principles of divine truth, then I'm sure there must be lots of followers.
Yeah.
But I don't know them. Mm-hmm. They're not people that we engage in our day-to-day life or even have communication with in our day-to-day life. So firstly, we need to talk about this idea or concept of followers.
Yeah.
This is a charged statement, which is a very clever way of trying to attempt to state that there is a cult because you've got followers. But the reality is, under the definition of followers, most religious faiths would have followers, and therefore they would all be cults.
Mm-hmm.
And many of them are, by the way, cults, in my opinion, because they do force things upon people. They try and manipulate people. They try to control people. They have a list of written rules and laws, none of which we have.
Yeah.
But the religions have them. Mm-hmm. So in my opinion, they are cults more than I am a leader of a cult. Or trying to begin a cult, because we have no desire to begin any organisation other than the organisation we already have, which is Divine Truth, which is just a physical business organisation required for tax purposes in Australia.
Yeah.
So the question was then about the
relationships
our so-called followers have.
Well, do you control what relationships people have?
No, not at all. They're allowed to have their own relationships. I encourage you to have as many relationships. I'm not talking about sexual relationships here, but I encourage a person to have as many relationships with as many people as they possibly can. Mm-hmm. Develop friendships, develop relationships, live in the world. You need to be of the world, but not a part of the world. Right?
And in the world, but not of it.
Yeah, maybe. The world, but not of it. Mm-hmm. And what I mean by being not of it, be love instead. You know, there's a lot of unloving things that go on in this world. Don't do those things. You know, don't practice those things. Demonstrate what it's like to be love instead, to be loving individual instead. Now, there are many people who have issues with their relationships. There are many people who come to us and ask us for advice with regard to their relationships. We have on the internet a whole series of frequently asked questions about partner-based relationships and parent-children relationships. My suggestion is, if you want to hear what I'm saying about relationships, go to those and have a listen to those.
Yeah.
You'll see that they are, all of the statements will make logical sense. They will all be loving and truthful. They certainly won't be implying that you've got to do what I say. They won't be implying that just because I'm Jesus, you should listen to me or any of those other things.
Mm-hmm.
They will just be statements of truth and statements of what is loving. That's all. And that's all we do. We make statements of what is truth, statements of what is loving, and how that impacts a relationship will be up to the people inside the relationship as to what they choose to do with that information. And we have no control over it, and also we have no desire to control it, just as God has no desire to control it. And we have no desire to break up people or desire to put people together. they all need to make their own choices regarding their own relationships. And what we do or don't do with them is just, all we do is share the truth with them, and we definitely do not tell them what to do. Mm-hmm. And I feel, again, it's pointless to tell somebody what to do, because sooner or later they are going to do what they want. What you need to do is encourage them to do what they want in harmony with love. And that's what we're trying to encourage people to do.
Mm. And really to find the rewards of acting in when love. We act in love.
Yeah. To discover the rewards of doing so. Most people don't understand the rewards of doing so, of course, and they don't even have any trust or faith in the rewards of doing so. So what we're trying to do is encourage that faith and trust in the rewards of living in a loving manner, mm-hmm. with everybody that you meet, including your partner relationships, your parent-children relationships, and all other relationships. Now, that means that you'll be loving to yourself and the other person. And this is where we see a lot of things breaking down. We see that a lot of people who accuse our so-called followers, only people who come along to our seminars, they accuse people who come along to our seminars of, you know, breaking up the family. No, many people who come along to the seminars are trying to be more loving to themselves, and in the process of becoming more loving with themselves, they realise they're getting attacked a lot by their family, and under those circumstances, they're trying to address the lack of love in their family. Mm-hmm. And we're encouraging them to do that, sure. Mm. Of course you would encourage a person to do that. That's what a psychologist would encourage a person to do, yeah. And that's certainly what I would definitely encourage a person to do, not because I'm a psychologist, but because I think that love is the most important thing you can engage.
Yeah.
And when you're being berated or belittled or humiliated by your family, that's not loving on their part. Mm-hmm. What are you going to do about that? There's something you have to do if you want to get out of that particular environment and learn how to become a loving person. And that might mean for a period of time that you withdraw from the family as a result. I'm okay with that. And so should the family be. Mm-hmm. The family shouldn't think that they can abusively treat somebody badly and then hope that that person remains connected to the family.
Yeah.
You know, that is a cult. A cult is a group of people who abuse another group of people, mm-hmm. and then think that that second group should remain with the cult.
Absolutely.
And that's what a lot of families are doing. Mm-hmm. And I don't encourage that at all. So again, these kind of questions are all related around, of course I've got a lot of advice that I give people about relationships. And of course I'm going to continue giving them, mm-hmm. because there are a lot of relationships on this planet that are completely out of harmony with love.
Yeah. Do you state any guidelines for proper relationships?
Certainly I do. When I say, well, a proper relationship, I don't know if I'd use that term. I'd probably use the term for loving relationships. Mm-hmm. Do I state guidelines? Certainly I do. If you have a look at the internet under the frequently asked questions, and you have a look at the series about partner relationships, and you have a look at the series about parent-children relationships, you'll see very clearly that I am stating a lot of guidelines of what I feel is a decent loving relationship in that regard, a decent loving relationship with your children if you're a parent, and a decent loving relationship with a partner if you're in a relationship or a marriage. So certainly, and I'm going to continue to do so. There is a deep need on this planet for people to start to understand what love looks like in a relationship. Mm-hmm. And what does love look like in a relationship with our children? What does love look like in our relationship with our parents? What does love look like in our relationship with our partner? Most people have no real understanding of those mm-hmm. particular things. And I feel it's very important to share that information. However, I don't share that information with, like, tell people individually what to do about the information. I just share the information publicly.
Yeah.
And what they do with that information is up to them. Mm-hmm. And I feel that's the best way to proceed with all the information we share. Share all the information publicly, share it as it is, in its nice raw format, unedited, and let people decide what they're going to do with that information.
Yep.
Some of them will want to follow it because they want to love. Others will want to criticise it because they don't want to love.
Mm-hmm.
And that's all right. If you want to criticise it, criticise it. But all you're doing is criticising a loving statement most of the time. And my suggestion is, you know, have a look at that. If you want to criticise love, then you know this is the reason why there's a lot of problems on the planet, because everyone wants to criticise love and no one wants to be loving, it seems.
Yeah.
So I feel quite strongly that we need to allow ourselves to present the information as we see it and let everybody who watches, you know, make the decision as to whether they feel it's, you know, cult-like behaviour or not. And in the end, everybody who watches regularly knows that they're not a part of a cult. They know that they're a part of a group of people who are attempting to practice loving principles in their day-to-day life. And it's not even a group in the sense they're just a group because of they're all having the same desire, that's all.
That's right. They're not physically together as a group.
They're not even physically together.
The majority of them don't know each other.
The majority of them don't even know each other, and we don't know them either. We've never met many of the people who listen to our material. And while we'd love to meet you if you're listening to our material, I don't feel that we're saying we don't want to meet you.
No.
We'd love to meet everybody we can. We're not what I would classify as motivated by the desire to meet people, have them involved with us daily, have them involved in our day-to-day life, or we be involved in their day-to-day life. We couldn't think of anything worse, in fact. What we like is our privacy, yeah. And we love doing the things we're passionate about. And the thing we're passionate about is sharing what we know to be God's truth with the world. So we're definitely going to be passionate about that for the rest of our life.
Yeah.
And if you want to listen to that, great. If you don't want to listen to that, great.
Great.
If you feel that it's challenging, great, because it is. And if you feel that you need to attack me, well, that's up to you. I don't think that's great, because at the end of the day, all you're doing is attacking a loving position, and that's never going to be great for your soul or anybody else. So I just feel like, yeah, if you've got that kind of attitude towards me, time to change maybe. And my suggestion is, if you want to accuse me of being a cult, then have a good look at all the other organisations in the world, because there are far more leaders and members of cults than any person who comes along to any one of our seminars. Or I am a leader, and I'm certainly not a leader of any cult, you know,
yeah.
And never will be. Yeah.
One key warning sign for a cult is that they keep people busy so they don't have time to question things.
Yeah, they're clever, aren't they?
Your humour, you kind of watch it.
I know, but that's the way it goes.
You're employing sarcasm. Do you keep people busy doing things?
No, no. In fact, quite the opposite. I encourage people to take time.
Mm.
I encourage people to try to become less busy in their day-to-day life so they have time to think and feel about what's really going on. The reason why people who are members of cults or leaders of cults generally want people to be busy is because they don't want them to think or feel for themselves.
Yeah.
You know, they want them to just toe the company line, I suppose you could say it. They don't want them to be able to be a free-thinking, free-feeling individual. And for a person to feel, they need to have time to feel.
Yes.
They need to be able to sit down and contemplate and reflect. And we encourage that greatly, as anybody who listens to our seminars knows.
Yeah.
So what we're trying to do is encourage people to slow down their life so that they have the ability to see what's really going on in their life and really feeling about what's going on in their life. So we do exactly the opposite of that,
yeah.
And as anybody who comes along to our seminars actually does know.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I do feel that this method is used as a way of controlling people. And you see it even used in business a lot nowadays,
yeah.
Where people are given more and more and more and more jobs to do without any time to even look at whether they did the last job well or anything mm-hmm. like that, or to be self-analytical about the job that they're doing. And I feel this is a way of detuning people from how they feel,
yeah.
And detuning them from thinking about things. And this is not what anybody who loves another would ever want them to, you know, the other person to do.
Mm.
So what we try to do instead is encourage people to slow down, take their time.
Definitely.
And all of the efforts anybody gives us are all voluntary. So, you know, and we encourage them every time, slow down, take your time, do things thoroughly, feel about what you're doing, think about what you're doing. Is it really what you want to be doing?
Yeah.
Because if it's not, don't do it.
Yeah.
These are the things that we say to people all the time.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. So mm-hmm. completely the opposite as to that accusation that's often levelled at us.
One key warning sign for a cult
mm-hmm.
is that they have a single charismatic leader.
Mm-hmm.
The media state that you are young and charismatic.
Oh, nice.
Does this not make you a cult leader?
Well, hopefully I'm young and charismatic. I'm 51 years old at the moment. And hopefully if they're saying that's young, that's pretty good. My feeling is I am enthusiastic for what I teach, certainly. And if that makes me charismatic, well, I'm charismatic, I suppose. But that's not how I see it. I see it as being enthusiastic for the things that I love and teaching the things that I love. And, of course, because I love them, my enthusiasm carries through with everything that I do. Mm-hmm. I'm enthusiastic about the way I engage my own life, and I'm also enthusiastic about the way I share the truth with other people. I think, again, people are, like, the media often have these accusations levelled at me as a way of trying to manipulate the truth. Mm-hmm. They're basically making the accusation that because I'm charismatic, it means that I'm manipulative. Or because I'm enthusiastic, it means I'm manipulative. And that's not the case at all. Anybody who knows me knows that I don't manipulate them at all. Mm-hmm. I talk to them about love, mm-hmm. that's all. And I don't manipulate or decide what they have to do with their life or their desires. But I am very straight and enthusiastic when I talk about love with people, certainly.
Yeah.
And I always will be, in fact. And I make no apologies for that because I don't feel any apologies are necessary. I feel people are afraid of charismatic people, though, mm-hmm. which is interesting. I don't understand why that is the case. Any person who's truly engaged and in love with what they do is surely going to come across with some kind of, like, enthusiasm or what people call charisma. And I feel that would be normal. In fact, if you really loved what you did, you would let this childlike feeling that you have about what you do shine.
Yep.
And I don't see any problem with that at all. I do feel that this whole accusation of being young and charismatic type of thing is a way, again, a media way of manipulating people. So they are being a cult, again, mm-hmm. by manipulating people by using certain terminology that suits what they believe are, you know, can justify their accusations of cult behaviour. And I feel that that's unfortunate. But the media, in my experience, have been liars. Most of them have lied to us. Most of them have lied to about us. There's been very few people at this stage that I've found in the media who have had any degree of ethics or morality. And those ones that I have found, I think are wonderful people.
Yeah.
And they are quite unique from what I've observed. And it's interesting. They say, many of the media people, when they first interact with us, say, don't tar us with the same brush that you're tarring other people. Mm-hmm. Now, I go, okay, so don't tar me with the same brush that you're tarring every other person who says he's Jesus.
Yeah.
You know, like, it cuts both ways, doesn't it?
Yes.
And what I find happening quite frequently is the media tars me with a brush of, you know, that all the other, if we can call them cult leaders, which are actually, in many cases, cult leaders who are manipulative, controlling, bossing people around, telling them what to do, none of which I do. They are tarring me with the same brush just because I'm saying that I'm Jesus. Mm-hmm. So just because I make the statement that I'm Jesus, they then think that they can assume, that they can make a lot of assumptions about me without any knowledge and without any personal experience. Mm. And I say to them, well, that's just the same as me making assumption that you're a media person, so you're going to be a liar and a cheat, because that's what every other experience I've had with media people, bar one or two, have been, liars and cheats. So okay, if you want me to treat you with some, like, open-mindedness, by saying, well, every person is an individual, then how about you start treating me as if I'm one?
Yeah.
Like, as if I might be different to the other persons that you've observed, because I can assure you that I am. Mm. I feel if people had that approach, then they'd probably get along pretty well with me with regard to any interaction. Yeah. But unfortunately, most people come into the interactions, particularly media people, come into the interactions with me already tarring me with the same brush that they've tarred every other person who said they're Jesus. And, you know, it just might likely be that I am Jesus, you know, you don't know. And Also, just because I'm saying I'm Jesus doesn't mean that I do the other things that other people who are saying they're Jesus do.
To be very honest with you, I doubt sometimes, well, I doubt, as you know, just about everything I see presented in a documentary these days, in a documentary format these days. So I don't even feel qualified to say that those other people who say, who do those things actually do.
Exactly.
Because my experience with the media is that they have lied.
With us.
With us. So how can I assume that they're not lying about those people?
Exactly. Exactly. Yeah. This is the thing. It is if they've lied about us, which they have categorically done.
Yes.
And done so many times that it's always, you know, it's just like, here we go again, yeah, type of thing, then of course they must have lied about other people. Mm-hmm. And so it's very, very hard to trust a person who continuously lies. And so this is why we have our different things that we engage with the media now, mm-hmm, where they've got to engage a promise with us to treat us lovingly if they want to have an interaction with us. Mm-hmm. Because if they don't, then we just don't even want an interaction with them anymore.
Yeah.
Because they are or have proven themselves to be, in many cases, very unloving individuals and collective organisations.
But to be clear, we ask for that promise up front, but we don't then treat them, or especially you don't treat them,
no,
with any level of prejudice beyond that point.
No.
Everyone has an opportunity then to show...
As I've said to every one of them, even during the filming... We've given you an opportunity here to tell the truth.
Mm-hmm.
And I, many times, as I've told you, know what they're going to do with that opportunity. And I know many times that I'm giving an opportunity they're just going to lie about.
Mm-hmm.
But at the end of the day, I'll give them one opportunity. And if they lie about it, then they probably won't get another.
Yeah.
And that's how God works too. You know, if you're going to continuously do something that's unloving, God doesn't give you other opportunities.
Yeah.
God waits until you learn the rule of what's loving and what isn't.
Yeah.
And that's what I'm going to do too, because I want to be at one with God. I want to be at one with the way God interacts with all of God's creation, including other people.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what we do, and that's what I do. So, no, I'm not some grandiose cult leader who has a, you know, grandiose following. If I was as charismatic as they all say, though, maybe I'd have more followers. Followers in the loose term of the word. Of course, we have no followers, so... Not very charismatic, obviously not charismatic enough to have enough followers.
Yeah.
And I do feel this thing of when you tell the truth to people, there's two kinds of people who respond.
Yeah.
There's the people who respond to truth going, I know this is the truth, I can feel it's the truth, and that attracts me to it.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's the kind of people who hate the truth. They just hate it, you know, and they'll do everything in their power to oppose it, lie about it, you know, accuse you, you know, try to, you know, kill you in the end. That's what they often do. And I'm very interested in talking with the first group of people,
mm-hmm,
the group of people who have a desire for truth and have a desire for love and have a desire for themselves to become more loving. And I'm not very interested at all in talking to the second group of people,
mm-hmm,
those people who have a desire to just ridicule truth and ridicule love and all those kind of things. I have no desire really to engage those kind of people. And to be honest, you know, the only types of engagement I have with those people are when they're forced upon me through some kind of circumstantial thing that occurs.
Mm-hmm.
And that's probably the way it's always going to be. Mm. But I wouldn't call that charismatic either.
No.
I would just call that logical. Why would you want to share your time, giving it away for free? Why would you want to share your time with a group of people who are just going to ridicule you? Of course you're not going to want to do that. Nobody in their right mind would do that. Then if you did that, you'd be crazy.
Yeah.
And I'm often accused of being crazy, but I don't do crazy things. Mm. Yeah, so that's probably my answer to the charismatic thing. I think it's, yes, I am a very enthusiastic person for love and truth, and you're always going to see that, and it's going to get worse. When I say worse, I mean I'm going to become more passionate and charismatic or enthusiastic about what I teach,
yeah,
as I grow.
Yep. And perhaps before we finish on this question, within the question it says that a sign for a cult is that they have a single charismatic leader.
Yep.
Can you talk to the singular aspect of it?
Oh, okay, yeah. Any person who is a leader in love and truth naturally will be a single leader You know, they will be different to the people around them, naturally. Yeah. So if I'm truly practicing what I preach, I will become a leader in what I practice and preach. Mm-hmm. And as a result, because it will be because I will be practicing exactly what I preach and doing that in my day-to-day life, right? Now, as I do that, naturally, I will stand out.
Yeah.
If I do that. And that's the case with anybody. Any good scientist in any endeavor will become a leader in their field. They'll become a single leader in their field because they've engaged a certain area or endeavor that they've become proficient and professional at.
Yeah.
And you know, driven by their own passions and desires, they've become very good at.
Mm-hmm.
And as a result of that, they will automatically become a person who is acknowledged as the leader in that particular field. Well, I'm the leader in the field of connection with God.
Yep.
Like, I am. And that's not a statement of arrogance, it's just a statement of truth. Like, no one else ever that I've ever met or ever have observed has ever come close to any of the reasonings that I have as a result of my connection with God. Now, anybody, I feel, who listens to the material I present will find that.
Mm-hmm.
However, that doesn't mean that I am better than anybody or more God views me as better than everybody else. God loves every individual on this planet just the same amount. It's their ability to receive that love is severely curtailed by their own actions.
Mm-hmm.
And so I don't feel I'm any special because of that position, but it is a position mm-hmm. currently that I suppose you could say enjoy. It's not something that might be permanent. There might be other people who eventually learn far more about God than I've ever learned, and so they would become the leader, and I'd be very, very happy to follow them
yeah.
once that occurs, if that occurs, and I'm okay with that.
And do you envisage there being sort of yourself in this leadership, sort of singularly with sort of helping people a long way back, or do you...
No, what I'm trying to do is I'd love every person on the earth to be a leader in love. Like, I really would. And that is one of my primary desires for returning back to earth, is for people to learn how to be a leader in love. I feel that it will take time for that mm-hmm. to occur. And there are many reasons why 14 of us came back to earth, and that was because they all had the opportunity also... Not that they necessarily are engaging that opportunity, but they have all also had the opportunity to become leaders in the same way,
mm-hmm.
leaders in love in the same way. So there's, I don't desire to have to be like at the pinnacle and everybody else be below me. That's not the way I feel. The way I feel is I'd love everybody to be my brother and sister who's doing the same thing as I am with regard to love and truth.
Yep.
That's what I would love. If everyone did the same thing as I do with regard to love and truth, all of the problems in the earth would disappear. There'd be no war on this planet. There would be no starvation, no malnutrition on this planet. There would be, most of our medical diseases would all have disappeared if they did what I did.
So you're saying if everyone listened to you, the world would be perfect?
Oh, the world would be a hugely improved place if everyone listened. But they don't have to listen.
No.
Right? And the only reason why it'd be a better place if they listened was because I listened to God. And the reality is if every person comes to practice what I practice, they would come to listen to God too. They wouldn't need to listen to me anymore. They would listen to God and they would know that going to war is the wrong thing. They would know that watching 50 million children starve every year because of the economy is wrong.
Mm-hmm.
They'd know all of these things and they'd do something about it if they really loved,
yeah.
right? And governments would do something about it because the people in the who vote for the government would want them to do something about it. And the medical profession would change and the government profession would change, the health professions would change, all of the religious faiths would change because all of them have unloving teachings that promote division and in fact, in some cases, promote war,
mm-hmm.
you know, and all of these things are out of harmony with love. And if everyone followed what I practiced, none of that would happen.
So then as a leader, do you feel that you are the model that people should listen to and copy?
Certainly.
Uh-huh.
No, like honestly, any person who practices love and truth in their day-to-day life becomes a model that any other person can follow. that, you know, to practice the same thing, of course. And if I didn't believe that, I wouldn't be teaching what I believed is the truth.
Yeah.
It makes no sense. Like, of course what I feel is the truth, I'm going to teach, and of course I believe it is the solution to all of mankind's problems. Otherwise, I wouldn't teach it. I would try to find some other solution that is real, you know?
Yeah.
But this is the real solution to everything. And it's the real solution because it's God's truth, mm-hmm. not my own. It's just something that I've discovered. And every other person on this planet has an opportunity to discover the same thing.
So do they discover it by doing what you do?
Yes, because there is only one. I've had to discover the way to do it. Each person on this planet is going to have to discover the way to do it. And the way to do it is the way I'm doing it,
yeah.
right?
So is that to get up and do 10 push-ups when you wake up in the morning and
no.
then eat like a green smoothie for breakfast and then, you know, I suppose what I'm asking you to clarify is when you say do as I do, basically, mm-hmm. I suppose there's a huge context or a huge body of work.
Of course, there's 1,200 hours at the moment of videos that people can see what I'm recommending to them
yeah.
that I do.
Yeah.
And the reality is it's all about the relationship with God and developing the relationship with God, allowing God's love to enter the soul. That'll transform you. That's when you will become a more loving person and individual, and then you will become a leader on the earth with regard to love and truth.
Yeah.
And then you will be doing what I do.
Yeah.
And yes, you will need to do what I do in order to have a relationship with God, because it's the only way you can have a relationship with God. It's the only way. There's no other way. There's only one way. It's
yeah.
the narrow and straight path I talked about that is mentioned in the Bible, and it's that's the only way. No, there's no other way to do this.
Yeah. Yeah, thanks for bearing with me. I was really just, because we're in a discussion about cults, and I know a lot of people could watch this as a standalone series.
Yes.
And I know in a lot of cults there is a lot of emphasis placed upon rules, as we were about to talk about in another question, and regimented routines.
Mm-hmm.
And when you're talking about doing as you do, you're talking about the way.
Of course.
As opposed to a lifestyle, I suppose, or a set of rules.
Of course.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's not a lifestyle, as you know.
No.
It's a way of life that is directly driven by desire for a relationship with God and doing what God requires to have this relationship.
Yeah.
And God requires that we allow love to enter us and we allow that love to affect our life.
Mm-hmm.
And yes, the way I'm doing it is the only way to do it.
Yep.
And you can try to drum up some other way if you want, but you're going to find that's unsuccessful. This is a tried and proven way over my last 2,000 years of my life.
Mm-hmm.
So this is what I'm saying to you. It is the way to God. I know many of you don't accept that and many of you don't believe it and many of you think I'm arrogant suggesting that. But later on in your life, you will find that I wasn't arrogant at all. In fact, I was quite humble in saying that this is the way
yeah.
and that this is the only way. I've had to come to terms with the fact that it's not my way, it's God's way.
Yeah.
And I've had to come to accept it just like you're going to have to if you really want to have a relationship with God.
Yeah.
But I don't force you to. You're not forced into doing it. You've got free will. You're allowed to do what you want.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't want to do this, then don't do it. That's mm-hmm. that's okay. Don't attack me for creating it, because I didn't create it. God did. And don't attack me just because you don't want to do it. Just own up to the fact I don't want to be loving and go away and be your unloving self if that's what you want to do. Don't expect me to agree with that, because I can't.
Mm-hmm.
I don't feel that anybody who chooses to be unloving is actually doing themselves or other people a service.
Yeah.
And they're not. So I feel quite strongly that if we all desired love and we all practiced love and we all desired truth and practiced truth and we all did things God's way, this world is going to be a remarkably different place. But it's up to you whether you choose to do it. I'm not going to force you. I'm just telling you the truth about it. That's all.
One key warning sign for a cult is that they tell people who to associate with. Do you tell people who they should spend time with and who they should stay away from?
Yes, I do. I say to them things like, you should spend time with people who love you. You should spend time with people who care about you, who are kind to you, who want you to grow, who want you to change positively, who want you to be loving, who want you to be truthful, spend people with time with people who care about, you know, your the progress of your soul. If you've got people around you who don't care about those things and attack you and think, don't spend time with them. You know, I definitely say to people that. Don't spend time with people who attack you, treat you badly, who want to humiliate you, be condescending to you, pull you down all the time. Don't spend time with them. Those people are just going to pull your whole life down, and they're not going to encourage you to be a better you. You know, they're going to make things worse for you. That's what they're going to do. You don't need to spend time with those kind of people. So what I've found is that there's people of all different types of religions who are of the first type, you know, who are encouraging, optimistic, positive. And then there's people of all different types of religions who are of the second type, who are discouraging, negative, you know, pessimistic, pull people down. There's people of all different types of scientific communities who are positive, optimistic, really good people to spend time with. Then there's people of the same kind of communities that are negative. What I find is in every walk of life, there are people who are either positive, optimistic, you know, who are kind, loving, want you to do the best for your life, enjoy your progression, enjoy your successes. And then there's all these other kinds of people who are terrible, attacking, pull you down, destructive. You know, you don't want to spend time with those kind of people. Leave those people to themselves.
Yeah.
Spend time with people who are going to help you progress and feel the and feel the joy of your own progression.
Mm-hmm.
So certainly that's what I would encourage people to do. I don't make a rule for them about doing it. Many people I observe in our day-to-day life spend time with the second group of people all the time.
Yep.
And ignore the first group of people all the time. Mm-hmm. They spend time with the second group of people, the people who are attacking and belittling, because they're afraid of them. And they try to appease them, and they try to, you know, please them and make their attacks go away. And, you know, in the end, that's just feeding the attack. Yep. That's pretty pointless, and that's what I observe most people doing. And the people that are really nice, that are great to spend time with, that are encouraging and really good to, you know, in terms of encouraging you to be optimistic and positive and desire to progress, you know, very few people seem to spend time with them for some reason. I don't really understand why, because they're not afraid of them.
Yeah.
is a big reason probably. And what I feel is that we need to spend more time with the people who we're not afraid of, and less time with the people who actually are attacking and belittling and controlling and, mm-hmm. you know, those kind of people. You know, we don't need them in our lives, really.
And that's regardless, I'm assuming you're saying that from your examples, it's regardless of what that person personally believes.
Yeah.
It's more about their attitude towards
you. It's all about their attitude.
Yep.
So they can be a Christian and have a really lovely attitude, or a Christian and want to murder you.
Yeah.
They can be a Muslim and have a really lovely attitude, or a Muslim and want to murder you. They can be a scientist who has a really lovely attitude, or a scientist who wants to murder you. They can have a political party, you know, in Australia here it's Labor and Liberal. They could be of any one of those two political parties and really be nice people, mm-hmm. or they can want to murder you, or treat you badly, or belittle you, or humiliate you, or be condescending to you, or whatever. Why would you want to spend time with them based on what they know? Surely you would rather spend time with them based on what you feel from them.
Yeah.
And what I feel is that we all need to learn to spend more time with people who are encouraging, uplifting, desiring love, desiring truth, desiring progression, desiring success, desiring all of these things, and less time with people who do the opposite.
Mm-hmm.
That's what we need to do. But I don't make any rules about it. It's up to you what you do with your life. But I can assure you, if you follow my advice on that regard, you'll have a much happier life. And if you find that you've let go of all the people who are negative, condescending, humiliating and all that, and you've not attracted this other group of people, well, there's something going on in your soul there that you have to work on.
Mm-hmm.
Because otherwise you would be attracting this other group of people who are more positive.
Mm. Mm. One key warning sign for a cult is that they hide their true teachings. Do you hide what you teach?
I agree that there are many cults that do hide their true teachings. Yeah, I agree with that. I'm not the leader of one of them. We don't hide our teachings at all. In fact, every single one of our teachings are publicly available in full on the internet.
For free.
For free. So we don't hide them by charging you a huge exorbitant fee for them. And we don't hide them by creating some kind of password that you've got to get into them. We don't hide them by any other means. We fully expose them to you, the person who's willing to be the listener. And the reason why we do that is because we feel that's the most loving thing to do. We believe what we are sharing with people is the truth. and we want to give it away for free. And so we're not going to hide it from people. We're going to let anybody know about it, whom we can.
Yeah.
And I do see that hiding things from people is a great way of controlling them. If you look at most families, there's a lot of hidden things in the closet, as the saying goes, yeah. in most families. So under this definition, that would make them a cult, right? And most families are cultish in their behaviour.
Yeah.
They are abusive oftentimes. They control the behaviour of family members through manipulation, and they control the behaviour of family members through the withholding of truth.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they go, oh, don't tell your brother this because, or don't tell your sister that, or don't tell my wife that, or don't tell my husband that. That's, to me, cultish behaviour, you know. Yeah. It's not something I promote at all. In fact, we promote completely the opposite. We are completely open about everything that we do. We put out all of our finances on the internet every year. We put all of our material on the internet every year. It's fully available for the worldwide public to see.
Mm-hmm.
And my suggestion is, if you're accusing me of leading a cult, then I tell you what, like, this is one wonderful cult that we're leading, because we're totally open and transparent about everything, which is exactly what I feel everything in the world needs to be.
Yeah.
Like, every political party, every government, every religion, every single person needs to be totally open, not only about their own opinions, but their finances and everything, single thing else about their life.
Mm-hmm.
And I challenge you, particularly those of you who accuse me of leading a cult, to do the same as what I'm doing, and I bet you find it a lot harder than I do.
One key warning sign for a cult is that they hype people up into believing.
Mm.
Do you hype people up?
No, not at all. In fact, most people who come along feel like they have been not hyped up, and rather they come away feeling quite overwhelmed and quite like feeling like they have been disturbed rather than hyped up. And I feel if you interviewed most people who come along to our seminars, that's probably what they'd feel when they walk out.
Well, I observe a variety depending on... some people walk away feeling really excited about what they've learned.
Excited, yeah, perhaps.
But over time, I find that people still feel attracted to the truths that they're hearing. But it becomes, because this is a path, or the way is very much about introspection and working on oneself, then often people become more challenged by the level of work they realise is necessary in order to grow.
Of course.
I feel that's the
case. And I feel that most people, while I'm encouraging, and I'm always encouraging about a person living in harmony with truth and living in harmony with love and being more humble, you know, that I'm always going to be very encouraging about doing those particular things. I don't feel that I have hype. Hype to me is a false or a facade drilled up to generate an emotional response in a whole collective group of people, and that is all manipulative. And I don't agree with manipulating people's emotions. I do feel that it's important to state the truth.
Yep.
So if I feel that God's a wonderful being, I'm going to state God's a wonderful being and all the reasons why I feel God is. Yep. And if that then hypes the person up, well, that's up to the person, like if a person's encouraged by that or not.
Mm-hmm.
For some people, they feel very angry when I make statements like that. So, I feel like I don't hype people up. I tell people the truth. And I feel enthusiastic in doing so. That's what I do. But I observe that many religious leaders, when they get on their pulpits on Sundays, hype people up. And I observe many politicians, when they were getting ready for an election, hype people up.
So how would you characterise that behaviour? What do you
call? Well, many times they're saying a whole heap of things that they personally don't practice and they personally don't believe and they personally don't do themselves. And they personally don't even do in their private life, but they're saying it all publicly in order to get a certain emotional response.
Right.
It's a bit like a politician talking about, you know, like a politician in the USA talking about how important it is to you know, have the right to life, you know, and promotes not having abortion, when he himself has encouraged his wife to abort the child.
Mm-hmm.
You know, to me, that's a person who's hypocritical and also just hyping up a group of people to get a response, which is his own election. So it's very selfish. And I don't do that ever.
And do you feel as well it's about capitalising on the emotions that people are suppressing within themselves.
Certainly, certainly.
That's what I see when
a whole group of people is afraid of a certain thing, and you know that saying a few words will actually help, you know, make them all feel more afraid, and that they'll agree with you, and that's what you want. So you say all those words. So you're just hyping people up there. Mm. You know, I never encourage people's fear. No matter how much approval I'd get from it, I never encourage it.
Yeah.
And in fact, I do quite the opposite. That's why most people are challenged. I never encourage people's anger.
Yeah.
And that's why when most people get angry, you know, around me, it's because they want to get angry, not because I'm encouraging it or hyping them up to do so.
Yeah.
You know, these are things that a person does who's manipulative, and I'm certainly not a manipulative person, as you know.
Yeah.
And what I feel is quite often happening with regard to groups of people is that they are frequently hyped up based on the unhealed emotions that they have. In other words, what people are doing, people who are in power generally are doing, are manipulating the emotions of the individual so that the individual finishes up agreeing with the person's in power's policy or decision.
Yes.
And that is not a good leader at all. In fact, that's a terrible leader who does that, because they're just feeding the addictions of the populace.
Yeah.
And I don't agree with feeding the addictions of any person, and particularly a large group of people, I'd never agree with feeding the addictions. And that's why divine truth grows very slowly, because I don't agree with feeding the addictions of people, individuals or groups. And I feel the person who's you know, doing these things is generally feeding the addictions of people. They like engendering or encouraging certain types of emotions in order for them to get approval and therefore get a vote or to get some kind of, or even get a monetary donation, you know. You see a lot of this happening in New Age philosophy where, you know, people channel material because it makes other people feel good.
Yeah.
Like, I don't do that. I don't give information to people to make them feel good. I give information to people because I know it's the truth.
Yeah.
Not because it makes them feel good. And sometimes it doesn't make them feel good.
Yeah.
In fact, many people who've heard us feel like it doesn't make them feel good.
Yeah, what I notice when people get hyped up and manipulated is that they're often being told things that help them live in fear.
Yes.
Or live in their...
live in their addiction.
Addiction. Yeah. So it's finding a downtrodden group of people and giving them
To put it coarsely, it's like finding a whole group of people who are drug addicts and saying to them, I'm going to make a law that's going to let you be free to have any drug you want.
Yeah.
You know, of course those people are going to be hyped up and going to feel great about that.
Yeah. They're
going to think you're someone to vote for, right?
Yeah.
But it's not for their benefit.
Yeah.
All it is feeding their addiction. Most of us don't realise that that's what's happening emotionally to us. In many media presentations,
through advertising
and through advertising TV. And through other mechanisms, advertising is a great example of this.
Yep.
Where adverts hype you up or get you to feel a certain thing, but it's in order to buy something or do something that they want you to do, and I'm not into doing that at all. Like, what a person does with their life, right across the board, is up to them. All I'm doing is presenting the truth. If you want to hear it, listen. If you don't want to hear it, don't.
Yeah. On many of your videos on the internet, people are often crying, sometimes uncontrollably. Is this not just an attempt to make a person have an emotional experience so that they are no longer logical?
Definitely not. In fact, my feelings are, from my own experience, that whenever I've let go of emotions that are from my childhood, I've become a more logical person.
Mm-hmm.
So what I'm trying to encourage people to do is to let go of what are often called by, you know, psychologists and psychiatrists, the hidden emotions or what they often classify as, what's the term they use, subconscious emotions.
Yeah.
I don't feel anything is really subconscious, but I feel that these kind of emotions govern to a large degree the illogical behaviour of people in their day-to-day life. And what they need to do is release these emotions in order to grow.
Mm-hmm.
So what I'm encouraging people to do is to actually connect with and release those emotions. Now, sometimes in a seminar, a person asks me a personal question, and so I give them a personal answer, which I know to be true about their personal life. And that causes them to go immediately into feeling about their personal life. So they start connecting with the hurt child's feelings about their child life, mm-hmm. and they allow themselves to cry about it. And while I think that's wonderful that they've connected to such emotions, I don't believe it's very loving of them to stay in the audience while they feel them.
Yep.
I feel it would be more loving for them to actually leave the audience and have a good cry outside or sob uncontrollably outside, because while they're sobbing uncontrollably inside, they are affecting a large group of people around them. So yeah. I don't even agree with them staying in the audience while they're sobbing yep. uncontrollably. My suggestion to them is, right, you've connected to the emotion now, go and feel it. Let yourself go somewhere in private and feel what you now feel. Because all I did was make a statement of truth that triggered that feeling. All they need to do now is allow themselves to feel that feeling in a safe environment. And then an audience with 200 other people is not a great environment in order to feel. Mm-hmm. And it's also not loving to the 200 people for you to feel everything in front of them and have them impacted by your feelings, and particularly if it's very noisy.
So you don't endorse public cathartic kind of
displays
of
emotion.
No, not at all.
In fact, I feel it's very fake.
Yeah.
I feel public cathartism is not possible, in fact.
Yeah.
The only way that you can have a really cathartic release emotionally is by doing it privately. And while I'm saying things to people that cause them to connect to such emotions, I hope that they are loving to others and themselves, and that they go and do and feel that emotion in private,
yeah.
which is what I've done all my life.
Yeah.
And I've never done that publicly. There are times when I connect emotionally publicly, but I don't have nice big cathartic releases where I'm uncontrollable in front of groups of people because I don't feel it's loving to them mm-hmm. to do such a thing. I do that in my private life, as yeah. you know. So, yeah. so what I'm encouraging is what I do.
Yeah.
And when people stay in the audience or stay in a seminar, having these uncontrollable emotional sobs without any consideration of the audience, the rest of the audience, and I feel that's a bit unloving, in fact.
I have to say, within this question, I mean, there are people in our... It's very uncommon for someone to have a huge uncontrolled release of emotion.
Of course, yes. They have usually direct connections with a little bit of a dribble. And
I think sometimes people are so afraid of emotions that they then call that an uncontrolled crying fit
had a 2 minute cry.
A little weep and blows their nose.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. So I think also this question indicates the level of judgment there is about emotion.
Certainly.
In the broader community
Certainly.
Or in the public.
Certainly.
And the feeling that tears make a person illogical.
Yes, and that's not true. In fact, if anybody who's truly felt their tears will know that every time they've actually felt their tears afterwards, they've been more logical and more certain about the course of action they should take, not less.
Yeah.
So it's actually quite, it's quite false of people who make these accusations to say that I'm manipulating people in order to make them less logical when they themselves know through their own experience that every time they've released an emotion and had a good cry, afterwards they've become more logical and they know what to do.
Yeah.
So, it's a false accusation driven by media hype, I feel.
Yeah, and I suppose the only way a person... we discussed this in a previous question... The only way a person could be manipulated in their emotion is if you were somehow manipulating them to feel false emotion or to avoid true emotion.
Yeah, and I don't agree with any of those courses of actions. You know, I don't want them to feel anything that they don't have to feel.
Yeah.
And I also don't want them to feel anything as a fake expression in order to get approval.
Yeah.
They need. I know. And the reason why I know is because I know with God, that God's laws and rules are that at the end of the day, unless you're feeling the real thing, then it's of no benefit to you.
Yeah.
So why would I encourage other people to not feel the real thing? Of course I'm not going to. So I feel that certainly I am encouraging people to connect emotionally. In fact, if they don't connect emotionally, they will never have a relationship with anyone, let alone God.
Mm-hmm.
You need to be connected emotionally to have a relationship with your partner, to have a relationship with your children, to have a relationship with God, and in fact to have a relationship with anything else, including a job or any other thing that's inanimate.
Yep.
You need to be able to be connected emotionally to it in order to have some kind of real relationship with it. And so being an emotional being is an essential part of the human soul. And that's why we've created a whole series of FAQs about the human soul, talking about the necessity of people to become more emotionally connected. We're not suggesting that the uncontrolled sort of delivery of emotion to the rest of the world is actually the right thing to do. No. That's not what I'm suggesting at all. Because if you have an uncontrolled expression of your rage, you'll go and murder somebody. And that's certainly not what I'd like to see anybody do. You need to feel these emotions in the privacy of your own home, usually, in your own space, so that you can develop. This is what you need to do if you're ever going to have a connection with yourself or a connection with the environment or a connection with God or a connection with any other person. Yeah. So I feel it's an essential part of our progress. But of course, I don't try to manipulate people through those particular connections.
Hmm. One key warning sign for a cult is that they control how people live. Do you control how people live?
No, in our day-to-day life, we do not control how people live. We don't even live with people to control anybody how they live. I don't even control how you live.
No.
And you don't control how I live.
No.
So we don't even do it with each other. And we certainly don't control how other people live because we have no idea how they live. Most of the time, we haven't met them in their personal day-to-day life. We have close friends, of course, just like anybody does. But other people, we've only met them at a seminar, or we've met them very infrequently.
Yeah.
And as a result, we don't really know how they live their life aside from what we can gather from their own emotional condition that we can feel. Mm-hmm. And we certainly don't control how they live. In fact, to control how somebody lives, you've really got to live with them. And that's why cults generally have compounds.
Yeah.
And we don't have one.
No.
And that's why cults generally have great big organisational things that they set up in order to control how people live. And we don't do that either. We want to promote the God's truth and the way God planned for us to live. But we do that by our personal example, not by you know, imposing a whole set of rules or guidelines upon other people.
Yeah.
If people ask us how what would God feel about this or what does God feel about that, then we'll help them reason about that, what would love do in those mm-hmm. situations, rather than even tell them. And we feel it's very important that people reason about these matters because they need to learn for themselves what love is, and they need to learn for themselves how to be truthful and honest with themselves and others, and they need to learn for themselves how to be humble and self-analytical. So they are the things that we primarily try to teach other people.
Mm.
And, of course, you can't tell people what to do when you're doing that.
Mm. Many so-called Christian churches believe that if someone like you denies that the Bible is God's word, this makes them a cult leader.
Mm.
What would you say about this assumption?
Well, they've just made every scientist on the planet who doesn't believe the Bible is God's word a cult leader, and they've just made every Muslim a cult, on the planet the same, and they've just, do you know what I mean? Like it's totally illogical, these mm-hmm. kind of arguments are totally illogical. The Bible is not God's word, quite simply, and I'm going to state that quite simply. And if that offends you as a Christian, well, I don't know why it does offend you. I don't see why you don't think the Bible itself is offensive towards God, to be frank. Like, the Bible talks of a God that is completely out of harmony with love, that punishes people, destroys people. The Bible paints God as the worst dictator in human history, right? And the worst murderer in human history, in fact. And also that in the future, God will become the worst murderer in human history is what the Bible portrays.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm asking you, why do you believe such a book when it portrays God like this?
Mm-hmm.
God's nothing like this. The Bible itself, when it talks about God, is blasphemous towards God. Now, there's no other way I can say it. Like, that is the truth. Now, how could you then say that just because I'm saying the Bible is not God's word, that it means that I'm a cult leader? Well, I don't see the relationship myself. And also, that automatically makes almost every other religion other than the Christian faith cults, which is also very, very derogatory towards those other religious faiths. And the reality is, many of them are cults, I know, because of their behaviour, but certainly not my behaviour doesn't mirror their behaviour.
Yeah.
Like my behaviour personally is that I believe completely that God is a God of love. God is a God of truth. God loves every individual. God never wants to punish anybody. God is always looking for the prodigal to return, which is something that I taught, which is even recorded in your Bible.
Mm-hmm.
And if you think that Jesus is going to come along and tell you that the Bible is God's word, then I'm sorry, there is never going to be a Jesus who comes along and tells you that, who's actually the real Jesus. Mm-hmm. He's going to be just a fake person, just like the other fake people that you've believed in who are teaching those particular concepts. The truth is, the Bible does not portray God to be the person God is.
Mm-hmm.
That's reality. The Bible does not portray me to be the person I am. The Bible does not portray many things that are truthful. It does contain truth, just like many holy books contain truth. The Quran contains truth. It doesn't mean it is the truth.
Mm-hmm.
It contains truth. And what we've got to do is learn to have the discernment to tell when we're being told the truth and when we're not.
Mm-hmm.
And the only way that you really gain that discernment is by having a loving connection with God and having love in your heart. Then you can actually measure everything that's being said against the yardstick of love. And once you've measured it against the yardstick of love, you can easily determine what is true and what is false. And that's what we all need to learn to do, no matter what faith we are from or what historical background we have. We need to all examine the yardstick of love and use that as the measure of everything. And when we use that as the measure of everything, well, there's very few things on this planet that measure up.
Mm-hmm.
There's very few religions that measure up. There's very few political parties that measure up. There's very few organizations, businesses that measure up, because they're all promoting unloving practices. And what we need to do is learn to use love as the yardstick of measure. And once we start doing that, we will have the means individually to determine what is true and what is not.
Mm-hmm.
And what I'm suggesting to you is that that's what you need to do. If you believe the Bible to be God's word, then I suggest to you that you have never used love as the yardstick, and you've never done it sincerely. And you need to do something about that if you're ever going to have a relationship with God.
Mm.
And don't expect any Jesus in the future to come along and say the Bible is God's word and actually be the real Jesus, because the reality is no person who knows the truth about God can agree with the Bible on all things.
Hmm.
Now, there are things in the Bible I certainly can agree with, but the whole Bible, no, I definitely cannot agree with it, because it does not contain the truth about God. It does not contain the truth about myself. It does not contain the truth about love and many other things. It contains portions of truth, just like any other man-made, man-written document. It contains portions of truth, and it contains portions of truth about my life. It contains portions of truth about God. It contains portions of truth about relationships and so forth, and portions of truth about the universe. But it doesn't contain all the truth, and it's impossible for it to contain all the truth. So if that makes me a cult leader saying those things, then I must be a cult leader. I don't agree that it makes anybody a cult leader to disagree with the Bible. Just like it makes nobody a cult leader to disagree with the Quran or any other thing for that matter.
Yeah.
Each individual on this planet is allowed to have their own opinions, and I'm an individual on this planet who's allowed to have his own opinion. That doesn't make me a cult leader. It makes me an individual who's got his own opinions.
Cool.